All right, so you guys are going to love today's topic, maybe, and that is about consumer traffic is starting to trend down. We're going to cover a little bit of that, also get into some of the general market sentiment in some of the major brands out there today. My name is Paul Barrow. Welcome back into the Restaurant Report. Great to see you guys. All right, so let's get into a few topics here. I want to go into some of the news items first. There's a few big news stories that hit this past week, but some of the things that I really want to get into in the back half of the show here is the consumer trends. And part of this is going toward actual restaurant visits starting to trend down. I want to jump over to this first story though, and that is the California State Senate now passing a major restaurant labor compromise. This is actually a bigger deal for the state of California. And there's a couple of reasons why. In the original bill that they went out with, there was a labor force that essentially had a lot more control over how wage law would be put into place in California. If you look back at the story, a couple of the things that Restaurant Dive kind of broke out, the deal passed, this all goes, and it was a fairly significant vote variation. Let me kind of zoom in on that for you guys if you were watching this on video. But the deal was an amended version of the AB 1228 bill, which repealed and replaced the Fast Recovery Act. So this was going to institute a wage-setting council composed of representatives in the industry, labor, et cetera, with the power to advise rather than modify. So working conditions at fast food chains with more than 60 units nationwide. Now, where I think this rolls out from is that the key here words were advise versus modify. The previous council would have the ability to actually get bills in place or get laws in place for major fast food concepts. So this actually helps the fast food concepts on the labor side, because now this committee is designed to advise scenarios that play out within within the proposals that are coming into it. So the passage of the amended bill kills the possibility of a California joint employer liability law for the time being. Another big deal. Though the National Labor Relations Board is working on its own standard, that's still under control of the National Labor Board. The other thing that is interesting here is, let me kind of jump down here to this one section. It says it's replacing the council that has the power to set wages within a narrow band and to send proposed rules to the state labor commissioner to amend, repeal, alter, or put through the standard rulemaking process. And this makes the council a weaker regulatory body and more of an advisory commission than a standard setting body. That was the big complaint of most of the industry out there, especially in the multi-unit concepts. And I think this was, you know, if you are pro restaurant concepts or if you're pro labor, this falls in two things. I think the pro labor side is at least there is a council still in place to be able to propose these kind of changes in the state of California, still our number one state in terms of total employees in the restaurant industry. But if you're pro-restaurant side, this does at least give you a position where it's not just mandated that these kind of rules go in place. There's actually an advisory and a process that they go through. So most likely more study and more analysis. I think this is good for the state of California, and it's been one that they've been working on for a while. The law sets the minimum wage for workers at QSR chains with more than 60 units at $20 an hour, beginning April 1st, 2024. And then following that, the council can set the wage level each year as long as the increase is below 3.5% or the rate of general inflation, which right now, inflation at almost 5%, you know, this could get pretty expensive for a lot of the restaurant concepts. So very interesting scenarios playing out in California. The $20 wage represents a huge investment in the quick service restaurant industry and employees. It's going to be certainly a challenging for the sector that has so much competition, but it's one that we're comfortable with. I think the scenario, and you know, we've talked to Andrew Wiederhorn, who is the board chairman and also on Fat Brands, said that the deal was reasonable. Everyone wants their employees to make more money. Obviously, we'll see things play out, I think, in the restaurant space around a lot more automation, because we have started to see a decline in the number of employees that are being used, mainly because of the automation that's being integrated. So maybe that is the counterbalance, is what technology is doing to help keep those costs a little bit lower. Moving on here, I want to get into a legend, and that is Mr. Howard Schultz resigning from the Starbucks board. Of course, he has been one of the icons in the coffee industry for quite some time, and really pretty much the bellwether of Starbucks in general. And leaving the board is a big question, because I think when you look at this brand, There's been two things that has created culture there. Now, some of it is Howard Behar and his original culture set, but also Howard Schultz. And Schultz has been one that I think everybody needs to pay attention to, because this step away, especially from a board at a time right now that they're facing such issues within not only the labor laws, but also in the brand itself being able to grow. This brand has still been able to do some pretty innovative things. Obviously, they launched a lot in the Web3 space. If you guys haven't seen their Starbucks Odyssey, you should check that out. But he did step down off the board, and his resignation now comes several months after he stepped aside as the interim CEO. And this is, of course, Laxman Narasimhan, who is back in there. But there is a senior advisor to the Alibaba Group that's going to be taking Starbucks' board seat on October 1st. So that's happening just around the corner. So I don't know. I'd love to get you guys' feedback. If you think this is a good thing for Starbucks as a brand, or if you think this is going to hurt it, make sure and leave some comments over on the Substack and or hit us over on Twitter, which is just Savor_FM. All right, let's get into one of the big IPOs that happened this year, and that was Kava. Kava has been a company that we've tracked for quite some time. They just filed their second quarter 2023 highlights. I'm going to zoom in on this and get into some of the detail, but Kava grew 62.4% to $171 million as compared to $105 million in the prior quarter. Pretty good growth overall. Net Kava restaurant openings, 16, so that's up 43%. And then also same store restaurant sales. This one was the big one right here. The Kava same store restaurant sales setting in at 18.2%. That's a significant improvement. Of course, this is one of the reasons this brand has been flying off the charts in terms of overall sales. Kava AUV, $2.6 million as compared to $2.4 million, so they are edging their AUV up slightly. And the restaurant level profit of $44.6 million grew 91% over the prior year. This is a this is an issue, because I take issue with this in two factors. You know, we've seen a lot of restaurant growth, and I'm not anti-profit, I'm very pro-profit. But there is a certain set of times that I think restaurants are going to need to be able to deal with what's happening in the consumer mindset, which is where we're starting to see a little bit of the consumer mindset moving away from restaurants, consumer sentiment, and also consumer traffic down. I'll show you some data on that in a minute. Kava digital revenue mix, 36%, pretty strong right here. And I think overall, this is most likely going to be one of their core areas of growth in the coming months and years. The likelihood of Kava starting to edge up to 37-38% is real, and that's a pretty significant pace on digital. So just be paying attention to what they're doing. If you're a brand leader, this is a good case study, because they've done so many good things from a digital aspect to be able to grow sales like this. So pretty interesting and also pretty amazing. The group net income, $6.5 million compared to a net loss of $8.2 million in the prior year. That's a huge swing. And then the EBITDA came in at $21.6 million compared to $5.9 in the prior year quarter. So again, another huge swing for them. Some of this has been in price increase. Part of this has been in enhanced branding and marketing. But I think a lot of this is just the fact that Kava has been able to do so well in the consumer sentiment. If you guys are following our Restaurant Power Index, which is where we track sentiment on many of these brands, I'll show you a few. Kava's segment tracking right here, you can kind of see a couple of things. Kava in the red chart right there versus overall food sentiment in that green, overall service sentiment, and then the restaurant market sentiment as a whole. So Kava is indexing now. They had slipped a little bit back here in the beginning of 2023 and has started to climb here through the summer. So with the last report in July, Kava continues to do a little bit of a zoom up on that, over-indexing right now in terms of overall sentiment compared to the restaurant market as a whole. The other brands I want to kind of bring note to is McDonald's. McDonald's has pretty much been flat, but one thing to note here is that McDonald's sentiment has been consistent throughout the year and is considerably overperforming the overall market. That is a testament of where McDonald's has gone and really continued to hold a great brand position. So kudos to them. Starbucks, very interesting stuff. We added in a sentiment component on their Web3 project Odyssey just to kind of get an idea of whether or not Odyssey was interesting from consumers in general. overall sentiment on their new Web3 project. Odyssey is doing really well. And of course, Starbucks has been holding a fairly significant top line sentiment over the rest of the market. Much like McDonald's, they had had that 83.57 back in October of last year. Here we are in moving in September of this year, and through the month of July, they had an 81.26. So not bad for Starbucks. Again, it's been holding sentiment overall. And I think the scenario with Starbucks, when you look at them, is they've done a couple of things right, is they've continued to, one, introduce new products. But the thing they've really done a good job with, and have always done a good job with, is their branding component. They just don't let go of that. They really continue to accelerate that. And that's one of the things I think when I look at restaurants and brands is some brands will start out with these great, you know, marketing campaigns or, you know, digital initiatives, and they start to back off. They start to slow down, or they start to shift the narrative, as opposed to just to continuing to double down. I know that's difficult to do, but when you look at brands like McDonald's, of course, they have deep pockets, and Starbucks also deep pockets. But you could look at a brand like Cava, which is, even though a publicly traded brand, is a much smaller unit count. Now, can a small independent be able to do this? I think that's the challenge that everybody has always been looking at and trying to solve. All right, so let's get into kind of the main story of the day. By the way, if you're not following our Substack, go over to saver.fm. You'll find, first of all, the Restaurant Power Index. You can just click on that top banner right there. This is how you can get access to a lot of these charts that I just showed you. All you have to do is just click on that, become a member. It's going to take you over to our Substack, and this is where you can actually get analysis and additional content over there, as well as all of our podcasts and all of our series. By the way, we've got a whole slew of series coming out from the Prosper Forum event that we just came back from. Almost, I think, 20 podcasts that came out of that. So check out just our Substack, which is saverfm.substack.com. So you'll be able to see all the podcasts and all the news. Let's get into the biggest news story, and that is the declining consumer traffic and also the sentiment starting to slip slightly. So something bad is happening around the corner. This was back in August. Why consumer spending drop is likely in the fall. Now, we've already seen Chair Powell put a lot of pressure on business in general just because of the interest rate that continues to press on the Fed funds rate. But one of the things that I'm looking at is this sticky inflation number. And the sticky inflation number, inflation up slightly again this month after just last week's report, is I think going to be one that we really have to pay attention to in October and November, and mainly because of the jobs numbers. The jobs numbers we'll start to see at the end of this month and next month, I think will start to give us a lot more insights. And I'm not talking about jobs in the restaurant industry, but jobs in general that will affect consumer spending. A couple of points here from CNBC. This was Dana Peterson said CNBC's Small Business Playbook virtual event. This was on back in early August. There are significant roadblocks ahead that would cause consumers to cut back. One of those factors is the student loan payments, which will resume in October. That, I think, will have a certain impact. I don't think that's the bigger one. I think the bigger one is going to be inflation as it continues to drive up prices. And that's what they kind of go into here in the article. Record inflation only a year ago, over 8%, continues to decline. Consumers are growing more confident about the economy and their finances, but they're saying that now the trio of forces that led consumers to pull back on spending is going to be the likelihood of jobs, the sticky inflation that is not pulling off, and these high interest rates that is going to continue to put pressure on consumer spending. We just reached the highest level of consumer interest being paid in the history of this being tracked. So that is a big factor as well. In other words, a lot of consumers right now really relying on credit as one of the keys to keep up with their lifestyle. And that's a problem because typically restaurants fall directly in that lifestyle bubble. So it's something to continue to watch. Now, one thing that has kind of contributed to this, this was an article by QSR Magazine. They do a good job over there. What was this whole idea around work and this concept of the work reimagined? So it's done a lot of changes in not only how people work, but also the process in terms of productivity. This came out just this last week, productivity down almost 20% by many companies that had remote workforces. And these are the challenges that these companies are starting to deal with, which could be leading to a next round of layoffs. And that's the big question, because remember, we had a huge round of tech layoffs. Everybody from Meta, Microsoft, Twitter, you name the tech company, Google, all of which hit the market. Now we're starting to see that coming into midsize and small business, where layoffs are starting to become a reality. That is the bigger factor here that I think continues to push the consumer into a very precarious situation. And that usually will affect one of the major spending categories, and that is eating out. So if you're paying attention to this right now and you're a restaurant executive, let us know what you guys think. Send us just a note, just a producer at us at revernetworks.com. You'll be able to send that in to us. And we always get kind of some feedback occasionally. And you can also hit us up on the DM over on Twitter as well. Last up here was the restaurant visits. So restaurant visits decline as consumers buy more ready-made meals on a weekly basis. This is another factor that I think that's coming into not only the restaurant industry, but they're changing up, meaning consumers, they're changing up the way in which they're eating out. So in some cases, they'll do add-ons, which means they might go into a restaurant, buy a single core item, then add on to it either from a grocery occasion or from home. And that is a big factor because it does reduce the average unit volume and also the average check. The other thing that factors into this, a couple of points that were pretty interesting to watch. Let me go in here. These are the percentage of respondents who made restaurant purchases in the last month. And look at this number right here, May 23 versus June. This was 67% versus 58%. Now in July, early indicators on this from our data is now dropping that now close to 53%. So another 5% drop in overall restaurant purchases declining. So this is a big problem right now. Also, the average amount per person spent during the last restaurant purchase, this is what I'm getting at right here, is that they're starting to offset what they're buying. So either they're just buying less of, or they're starting to look at lower cost menu items, or they're starting to do the concept of just bringing home a certain amount, especially in the takeout sector, and then adding on to that at home. This is a big deal because it's dropped from almost $28, which was at its high back in April, on the average, down to $24. So this is a pretty significant reduction, almost 20%. So pretty big deal. Some of this is because of rising menu prices. Some of this, I think, also have just because of the macro scenarios that are playing out into the market. I'd love to hear back from you guys. Are you seeing continued lower restaurant traffic from your own brands? And if you are, let us know. And if you've got a topic that you think would be a good discussion for the podcast, just reach out to me. Again, it's just producer at revernetworks.com. You'll get our producers and just pitch your idea, because sometimes we get executives that want to come on, talk a little bit more about what they're doing right. Maybe that can help other restaurant operators out there in the space. All right, guys, make sure, again, as I said, if you're not following us over on Twitter, it's just saver_FM. And then, of course, go over to our Substack, which is saverfm.substack.com. Again, thanks again for listening in on the Restaurant Report.